Good afternoon, respected Financial Commissioner, my co-panelists on the dais, and all the distinguished guests here. The topic that I am going to cover is on accounting reforms, challenges, and solutions. A whole lot of conceptual background has been covered during the deliberations so far, so I will not repeat those things. Talking about the traditional way in which government accounts are kept, which is on cash basis, and this has been the trend in the government so far, except that where government starts providing services such as transportation and postal, etc., it creates a unique problem of how do you price the services. And when you try to price the services, it also comes to the point of how do you capture costs, how do you account for your expenditure and earnings, etc. So therefore, a true measure of cost, profitability, and sustainability of such services needs to be arrived at. And in that sense, the concept of accrual accounting takes center stage. We are maintaining our accounts on cash basis, but here at this point of time, talking about certain strengths of railways as an organization, it must be recognized that railways meet their entire operating expenses, including asset replacement and pension, out of their revenues. We are not dependent on any external source for financing any of this. On the capex side, we get about 28% as the gross budgetary support from general exchequer, about 14% through internal generation, and the last bit is very important. We are now budgeting for almost 49% through market borrowings, either through IRFC or through external budgetary resources like LIC, PPP, etc. Now, these are the stakeholders that have a keen interest in watching the way railways finances are depicted. What are the expectations? The expectations are both from internal as well as external stakeholders. The external stakeholders would like to look at our accounts in the way that they are universally depicted across the world. They would like to understand how the different lines of business and lines of services are performing. They would also expect our pricing and tariff decisions to be objectively based on certain reliable cost data. Internally, as internal stakeholders, we would like our resources to be managed much better. We would like to know what are the economic break-even points, and we would also like to know how we can improve the value proposition to the customers as service providers. The basic components have already been touched upon. When we do right accounting, we are enabled to do right costing, and therefore we are in a position to do right pricing. And once we have these basic components in place, we are able to dovetail our budgeting process by linking all the outlays with outputs and therefore the outcomes. We are able to objectively look at, and how we are going to do this is something I'll touch upon in the course of the presentation. The journey so far, we did a pilot project at NWR with the help of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, ARF. The entire team from ARF is here. A railways team from NWR and from Railway Board and everyone is here. We have worked tirelessly for the last 1 year in looking at the accounts of NWR and converting them into accrual-based accounts on a grafting basis, that is taking the accounts as they are and then grafting the accrual impacts from gathering data from various sources, which I'll touch upon in greater detail. The pilot study at Kapurthala is about to be completed, and I'm happy to inform that the rolling out of accrual accounting across Indian Railways and the performance costing as a pilot project has recently been approved by Railway Board. The Institute of Chartered Accountants would be helping us in the rolling out, and the Institute of Cost Accountants would be partnering us in doing the diagnostics on performance costing in Northern Railway. The outcome budgeting will also be taken up with the help of Institute of Chartered Accountants, which Mr. Venkatesh will touch upon in his presentation. What have we covered in NWR? We have covered the opening balance sheet as on 31st March 2014, the profit and loss account for 2014-15, the closing balance sheet as on 31st March 2015, the cash flow statement, the accounting policy, the notes to account, the entire works. What would constitute the annual report of a company is the entire components of that have been captured through the pilot study. The methodology, as I have explained, has been the grafting methodology. We have taken up the accounts of NWR as they are from the account current, the appropriation account, and we have captured the other elements which are relevant for accrual accounting through data collection. The basic requirement of any accounting structure is to have a set of accounting policies. Any company would be expected to adopt a certain set of accounting policies which would guide the maintenance of accounts and not maintain its accounts based upon the exigencies of the situation. So to that end, during the course of the study itself, we have formulated about 11 accounting policies for NWR, which would of course be applicable to the rest of the Indian Railways also. And it covers elements such as the basis of preparation of financial statements, the use of estimates, fixed asset accounting, capital works in progress, which has been repeatedly stated here as not forming part of our account. What we do in railways is when we spend money under demand number 16, we book it to the final head, even though the work is still in progress. Whereas under the accrual accounting, anything that has not been put to use needs to be shown separately as a work in progress. So that has also been done. Since we do not maintain an asset register in the format suggested, we do not provide for depreciation on a certain given principle. We provide for replacement of assets by contributing to a depreciation reserve fund on the basis of a recommendation given to us by a parliamentary committee. But as I would explain and depict in the accounts that we have made, normally does not have a correlation with what exactly do we need to provide in terms of the asset size that we have. We have also made policies for provision of contingent assets and liabilities, the valuation of inventories, the revenue recognition. The revenue recognition principle is important because we receive a lot of revenue, especially on the passenger side, in advance. We have a long advance reservation period, and the tickets that are booked in a particular month may not pertain to that financial year. Presently, we account for that entirely as the earning of that present year. But in the accrual accounting, it becomes important to segregate the two and not account for that portion which does not pertain to this year. This follows from the concept of matching. Because if I am accounting for the earnings in this particular year, the costs are going to be incurred in the next year. So the two things do not match. It gives a distorted picture of my earnings and expenditure. So therefore, it's very important that we do this segregation of revenue recognition. In case of passenger trains, what we have decided is that as long as the journey commences up till 31st March, the revenue would be recognized for this particular year. If the journey is to commence on 1st April onwards, irrespective of when I book the ticket, it would not be accounted for in this particular year. It would be taken as a current liability on the balance sheet. In case of goods traffic, a thumb rule has been arrived at, which is subject to fine-tuning as we rely more and more accurate information from the IT systems. The last 4 days of goods traffic, 2/3 is taken as the earning of the present year, and 1/3 is accounted for as the earning for the next year. Sundries are taken on accrual basis. Lease accounting is another important area. We take almost 68% of our rolling stock fleet is now not owned by Indian Railways. It is financed by IRFC. And the assets do not figure on our balance sheet in any place. We pay for their what we call lease rental, which has a capital component and a revenue component, and we capitalize it on a cash basis. So as long as I'm doing my accounting on a cash basis, this accounting is fine. When I make the capital expenditure, I account for it. When I make the revenue expenditure, I account for it. But in accrual accounting, as per the AS19, it is imperative that I take the entire size of the asset and the repayment liability on my balance sheet on day one. This is very important. This is a very important change, which I'll again cover in a little detail. What were the challenges that we faced while doing this pilot project? Challenge number one, trust me, was the asset register. We do not maintain an asset register as and when we acquire it. That is number one. Number two, we do not call everything an asset. We acquire assets through a capital demand. We also acquire assets through our revenue demands. And only those assets are called assets which are charged to demand number 16. Otherwise, it is not categorized as an asset. I may buy 100 computers, but I do not buy it off my capital grant. It is not accounted for as an asset. So if I do not account for it as an asset, where's the question of providing depreciation on it? So the only way was to go the hard way, created 17 different formats, distributed it to each unit, and requested the executive to fill up the details of all the assets available with them in that. Now that's easier said than done. When you start doing that, you face that you do not have many details available with you. And what do you do with that? That is one part. Related to that is the provision of accounting depreciation. Also, the long-term lease liability that I talked about in the previous slide. And provision of accrued liabilities not only on account of earnings, but also on expenditure. There are many bills, there are many works which have been done, which I have not paid for. There are many liabilities which I have incurred during the year, which I have not provided for in my balance sheet. So it does not give me a complete picture of what exactly is the size of liability that I have incurred in the present financial year. Last but not the least, and this is explosive, the provision of long-term actuarial liabilities towards retirement benefits. Any accounting system maintained on accrual basis is required statutorily to evaluate the retirement liability of the existing staff. And I'm not talking about staff who are already retired. I'm talking about staff who are on our rolls today as we talk and who are going to retire in the next 10, 15, 20 years to come. What is the liability? Do we have a fix on the liability under various heads like leave encashment, medical, commutation, etc., etc.? We need to quantify that. We keep on having an idea that this is a big sum, but how big? Let's see. The fixed asset register yielded 63,000 individual assets, 63,000 under 17 heads, depending upon their nature and class, out of which for 13,000 assets, we did not have cost data. And they were provided for at a nominal value of rupee 1, which is a standard practice. Once you're not able to ascertain the value of an asset, the normal practice is to cost it at number 1. These are, frankly speaking, extremely old assets. The combined value of these 13,000 assets may not add up to a very large figure, but then from a point of principle, the fact remains that we do not have a fix on the value of these assets. This includes 3,200 buildings, 1,700 bridges, tunnels, plant and machinery, etc. We didn't have the cost of asset, the year of acquisition, quota life in case of roads, buildings, bridges, tunnels was not available. Data was available only in a manual form. When we came to track, track has been laid for many, many years. It's there. What we could get was the physical data on track from what we call the track management system. We knew section-wise, kilometer-wise, what type of track, what type of sleeper. We had to correlate it by culling cost data from the records of Railway Board, an annual cost statement is given out, assigning values to these components. So we have valued track component-wise, not composite-wise. Each component like track, ballast, sleeper, fittings have been costed. In case of rolling stock again, physical data is available, but then financial data was not available. So we had to depend upon the data very diligently maintained by IRFC, because they have been financing rolling stock with the Indian Railways for the last almost 30 years. So we could get cost data from there. But in this also, we came across a peculiar problem that the assets that are initially assigned to a particular railway do not remain on that railway forever. Especially locomotives have a tendency of being assigned to, say, NWR and later on being transferred to another railway, but the financial liability on our books, because as per our records, this asset was leased to NWR. So who is running the locomotive? Who is bearing the cost of servicing the payment liability of lease assets is another issue that comes up. So taking all these things into account, we drew up the balance sheet of NWR. So there again, what I am trying to depict here is how does the balance sheet look on accrual basis as compared to cash basis. Again, repeat my point, we do maintain a balance sheet in our appropriation accounts. Howsoever deficient it might appear, there is a balance sheet. And I will tell you, I'll depict the various items of differences. Number one item of difference is that we do not maintain reserve and surplus, because we are funded from the government, and anything which is residual at the end of the year then reverts back to the government. We do not transfer anything to the balance sheet. The non-current liability finance lease obligation of 2056 crore, which is the outstanding capital value of all the lease assets which NWR has taken, has been shown on the balance sheet, which does not appear in a normal railway balance sheet. The finance lease obligation of the current year also is not maintained, therefore. And when we come to the asset side, as you can see, the accumulated depreciation of 3,845 crore, which is provided on the gross block, is absent in the block accounts of railways, because we do not provide for depreciation in this manner. The capital works of progress of 2,102 crore. These are all the works which are in progress, on which money has been spent. In our accounting system, these have already been booked to the block account. But in the accrual account, we have to segregate these and show them separately. Similarly, the inventories, the stores inventories, etc., which we booked to demand number 16, again forms a block, part of our block account, whereas we have shown them separately as inventories. Just to focus a little bit on the asset side again, on the gross block, if you can see, the difference is not that huge, but the accumulated depreciation of 3,845 crore creates a difference in the net fixed asset, which remain at 13,258 in railways and reduced to 10,944 in case of accrual balance sheet. The lease assets form a part of our total block, 2,270 crore. Now let's come to this, the actuarial liability for retirement benefits. The actuarial liability for retirement benefits adds up to 28,253 crore for NWR. Just one railway, 28,253 crore. And I compare it with the net worth of the balance sheet of NWR. The net worth of the balance sheet of NWR is 10,658 crore. So as you can see, the actuarial liability is more than the net worth. Of course, as in the previous session, Mr. Amarjit Chopra also said that various entities have found various ways of dealing with this problem. But this is a problem which cannot be brushed aside. I mean, we have been very lucky that we have been able to pay a pension from our operating revenue so far. But imagine a situation, a great business shock. We have seen it in case of pipelines coming on and taking away POL traffic. Imagine our revenue suffering consistently for a few years, and all these people retiring and we not providing for these things. What would happen? Under the cash-based system, we may not do anything about it. But at least to be aware that this is the ticking time bomb that we have with us should make us aware of the fact as to how we prioritize our expenditure, how we fill up our reserves. Is it enough to just give 1,200 crore to the pension fund, or maybe we need to give more and build up reserves over a period of time? So this is one aspect of it. P&L account, till the EBITDA level, the difference is not great, just about 10 crore, accounting for the entire earnings, etc., which we take on accrual basis. We do not provide for depreciation, which is 499 crore for the gross block that I have at the beginning of the year. As against this, the appropriation that I make to my DRF account is 291 crore. And so accounting for all this, the net surplus at the end of all provisions under the cash basis, which is 565 crore, reduces to 56 crore. And the difference being the under provision of depreciation that we need to make. In the entire process of doing this exercise, we have also simultaneously recognized the need of capacity building on Indian Railways. We recognize the fact that if we have to take this project forward, it will have to be owned internally within the railways, for which people at various levels will need to be trained. So we have training modules running at Sitara. We have training modules at NAIR. ICI ARF has been holding training for us. And they will be actually holding about 74 sessions of training during the rollout phase, as per the plan that we have done. And then we have also taken on board CRIS to be the IT enabler. Their help will also be taken in creating the IT awareness. Phase 2 and 3, ICI, the partner for rollout of accrual accounting and outcome budgeting, Institute of Cost Accountant for Performance Costing, CRIS will be providing us the IT development support. I'll just take a couple of minutes to delineate how exactly are we going to do this. We are not going to do this grafting method forever. We luckily have iPass available with us, which is a web-based solution which is being followed across all the zonal railways are now being spread to production units. We intend to take this as the basis and build two additional chart of accounts, taking data from here. One chart of account would convert this data into accrual basis, and also it would also be mapped to the costing parameters and the costing architecture that is going to be developed under the pilot study on performance costing. The entire solution will ride an IT application built upon the core of iPass, which is why the emphasis today now has been to spread iPass as much as possible, so that we are able to use this as a building block for creating an IT application, which can then make this system perpetually available to us on a constant basis. This is going to be a long journey. Somebody in the morning said, well, 2 years is too long a time. I would beg to differ. I think 2 years is too short a time. governments have taken between 4 to 7 years to shift to accrual accountings in countries which are much, much smaller than we are, where the working is much, much less complex than ours is. And I think keeping the entire cultural issue, the entire acceptability issue, the inertia and what have you. We have launched ourselves upon this project. We are very confident that we'll be able to do it and do a good work out of it. And we are sure that with the help and support of everyone around, and now we have got so many building blocks available to us, we'll be able to succeed in our venture. Thank you. Thank you.